Another day, another top 10 games of all time. Hi, I'm Alex Radcliffe from Board Game Co. and welcome to the top 100 games of all time. We're currently going through his number 70 down to 61. We are almost at the halfway point. We got one more video to go. That's the nature of like 50 would be half and all that. If you want to see more information about how this list was put together, some of the basic, you know, overviews and whatnot, I have 3 minutes at the beginning of the very first video in this series, number 100 through 91, where I go through some of the rules, details, things like that, that go into this top 100. But the most basic idea is these are my top 100 games of all time as of this moment in 2023, putting together the list using rankings and whatnot and figuring out what I think is the best for right now. Things change. There will be games that are left the top 100 this year that might come back next year. Games will generally shift down the list over time. A game that holds firm means you're doing a great job continuing to capture my attention because new things are always entering the mix. We're going to go ahead and start off shortly, but first, if you missed it, I did a video. I'll link to it down below. Basically, ways you can support the channel if you're interested, as well as in that video, I'm giving away 3 all-in pledges, giving away Zombicide Undead or Alive, Masters of the Universe, and an Oathsworn all-in pledge. You can go check out that video for details. There are ways to be entered by, you know, donating money to the channel, and there's ways to enter by literally just commenting on that video. But with that, let's go ahead and start this off, starting off with number 70, my number 70 game of all time, and it's another party game. I have at least one more party game after this, maybe more, I have to check the list, but number 70 is going to be Monikers, and this is just a delightfully good time every time I play it. I have like all 4 sets of Monikers, set, the other boxes are smaller, but there's still more cards, and Monikers is just 3 rounds of just trying to figure out what the other players are doing. You start off with a card. Let's go ahead and grab a card because I think it's an important component of every Monikers game. Let's grab a card from the middle over here and we're going to just deal with it. Oh boy. Okay, I'm just going to read from the card over here. The actor who played Jareth the Goblin King in the 1986 film by Jim Henson. Okay, so who's a famous actor, kind of lanky face, rock star, 40-year-old rock star? Great, David Bowie. But what was the movie he was in? He was in the movie called... Yeah, okay, great. So, to put it together, David Bowie... Exactly, David Bowie in the Labyrinth. Perfect. It's a 4-point card. I've earned it. That's round one. Round one, you're going through a whole stack of cards. You can say whatever you want except for the words on the card. In would be debatable. Some people would allow it, some people not. I'm not that fussy. But round two, you don't get to do that. Round two, you only have one word. And so you can do whatever you want. Maybe you say rock. Maybe you say baby. Maybe you say movie. But the problem is there's 50 cards in play and they all have different ways you're trying to get your team to guess your word with one single card. And round three, you move on to charades. And round three, you're suddenly going... I don't know, that was me rocking and then massaging a baby. I don't know. I'm weird. Let's deal with it. But either way, that's basically Monikers. 3 rounds, say whatever you want, say one word, it's charades only, and with that, you want to try to go ahead and give players the experience. Well, not the experience, you want to give players to get the answer. You want to win. You want to win the game. Winning's important. If you don't win, you don't have fun playing Monikers. That is going to be Monikers. That's not true, by the way. You can have fun regardless. Winning's kind of a completely circumstantial aspect to the game. Although it is fun when the games are close, I will say that. But either way, that's Monikers, my number 70 game of all time. My number 69 game of all time is going to be Endless Winter Paleoamericans. This game has dropped over time for me, although not necessarily too much of its own fault. Endless Winter is a game that came out a long time ago, and I loved it. I played the prototype, I loved the game. The game arrived, I loved the game. The one area where it has unfortunately been a little weaker compared to Dune Imperium and Endless and Lost Ruins of Arnak is the expansions for Endless Winter, to me, don't enhance the gameplay that much. They're fine, they're okay, but I'd rather play base game Endless Winter more often than not. I find I get enough out of that experience from base game versus the expansions are like just more. So I like the game a lot, but that aspect has led to it dropping a little bit compared to Lost Ruins of Arnak and Dune Imperium, which for me, the expansions elevate those game experiences so much more. Base game to base game, I think Endless Winter is my preferred. If you're talking about Dune Imperium or Lost Ruins of Arnak or Endless Winter, base game alone, I probably prefer Endless Winter. Arnak might be close. I really like Arnak, it's grown on me a lot. But either way, that's going to be Endless Winter. As far as the actual game itself, because I haven't really talked about that, just compared to the other games, Endless Winter is a deck-building worker placement game. It's a game which you're going to have 4 main lays of what you're trying to do. You're going to be trying to recruit more cards to your base, you're going to be trying to go hunting, you're going to be trying to get more culture cards versus more basic cards, and then you're going to be trying to spread out on a little Catan side mini board. But the way you try to go ahead and pursue all those actions across 4 rounds of play where it feels like you can't get that much done, but by the time the game is over, you have gotten so much done while trying to manage so many aspects, including the little side monolith board, the game is a little messy. There's a lot of things going on at your table, but the actual game experience it gives you is absolutely phenomenal. That's going to be Endless Winter Paleoamericans from Fantasia Games, from Stan Kudowski. Fantastic game, my number 69. My next one up over here is going to be number 68. I don't know what to do with the Monikers box, I'm just going to put it over here. My number 68 is going to be a big box over here, and that's going to be... Dominion. Dominion over here. This is going to be, and this, by the way, is a custom box. It's coming to you from One Sharp Joe. Make sure to go down and Google One Sharp Joe Crafts to go to his website, or you can just do One Sharp Joe Etsy. But he does a bunch of these inserts. He has great inserts for Marvel Champions, for Dominion, for a variety of other games. Any TCG, CCG, he's got all those inserts for them. But either way, he also makes, like, token holders and Lurkana bits, all these fun things. But this is going to be Dominion. This is, like, all of Dominion. I have two boxes of this. That's how much Dominion there is. And it's just cards after cards after cards of all the things Dominion out there, because Dominion to this day is still one of the games that has stood the test of time in my collection. Granted, I did get rid of it once, but I liked it so much that I hunted down my exact pre-sleeved copy to try to get it back, because I was like, I should not have gotten rid of that game, and it has not left my collection since. Dominion, designed by Donald X Vaxarino, is going to be a deck-building game. One of the games that popularized deck-building. I say one of them because there's so many, and how do you pick which game impacted deck-building at which time? There's going to be games from Martin Wallace that had deck-building way back in the day. Then there's Mage Knight that had deck-building. Then there's going to be Ascension and Dominion that kind of really popularized the hobby, but then Star Realms came along as well and had an impact. So many games over the years have had their own impact and mark on deck building, but Dominion is definitely one of those that's had a big impact and a big mark on deck building, and it has like 27 expansions at this point. Not 27, but there's a lot of expansions for Dominion, and I love the game. I have all the content for it. I think I have all the content. I have to double check. In fact, I upgraded it all to second edition. It is such a good game. There's so much going on for it. I just think Dominion is a fantastically good time as far as simple, accessible deck building that really forces you to examine how you want to build your deck. It's got a fixed card market instead of a variable card market, which for me is the difference between, hey, I'm going to buy whatever good card comes my way, versus I'm going to approach this with a plan, with a strategy, and try to figure out the best way to build up my economy and not clog my deck as you wind your way towards points. I think Dominion is fantastic, and I think it's worth checking out. My number 67 is going to be Apiary from Stonemaier Games. This is a new-to-me game this year, and this one has continued to grow as I've continued to play it. It has not been perfect for me. There's a reason it's here as opposed to lower down the list, but I do think Apiary is a great time. This, to me, is giving you a great tableau-building game. It's basically worker placement. Let's see if we can show you over here. It's basically going to be a B-worker placement in the game. You have the central board over here. You have your own individual player boards. You're grabbing tiles from the market over here, placing them down into your individual player board. All those tiles operate as farms, which help you when you recall your workers. These tiles over here give you things that improve as you take various actions, they improve them, and these are one-time benefits, and then these are the point-scoring tiles. You're gathering all of those and trying to place them down onto your own little board and buying extension tiles to add to your board. The whole time your bees are rotating up in power as you utilize them, but then eventually you're recalling them and taking benefits from a recall turn, assuming you got enough farms in play. The game gives you a ton of tiles that keep the game interesting. The game gives you a lot of things to work for every single game. I don't like the 5-player game compared to the 4 or less. My only pet peeve with the 5-player game is at 2, 3, and 4 players, the game augments how long the game is around the player count. So you get enough done because you're adding more stuff the trigger end game. Once you go to 5 players, it's the exact same scaling as a 4-player game, which just means you inherently get less done, and it's already a game that I feel crunched by when I play it. So 5 players is not where I don't think I'd ever play Apiary at 5 players again. I think I'd be actively resistant to doing so. But 2, 3, and 4, I think it's a great game. I have not played the solo game. Yes, there's a solo mode. That's going to be Apiary from Stonemaier Games. It's bee placement. Bees in space. That's the, that's what I thought, too. I was like, hey, bees in space. We need a game themed around bees in space. That's gonna be popular. Who decides some of these things? Who decides that these are, whatever, it's Stonemaier Games. They made a game about birds that sold 1 million+ copies. They're doing what they're doing. Anyways, that's going to be Apiary, my number 67. Coming in at number 66, I only have the expansion box for this over here because the other box is up there. That's going to be Xayah, Legends of Adrift System. This is specifically Embers of a Forgotten Star, which is Forsaken Star, which is their solo campaign, which honestly I want to play, so I'm actually a little bothered that I'm not playing this right now. I should really play this. I should read the rules and play this. Not the core game. The core game is my number 67 game. My 66 game of all time. It's the solo campaign that I really should play through. But Xayah Legend of Adrift System is a game of space exploration. It is a sandbox game, and I usually have a problem with sandbox games. I think they're phenomenal. I think they're amazing. I love sandbox games. I also don't like your turn. I like my turn and the things I'm doing and I'm pursuing. But very often these games work better at higher player counts. So it's this weird like situation where I want more players so that the game is better, but I want less players because I don't care about your turn. I just need you to be present so that I can continue playing the game I want to play. They're the kind of experiences that almost make me just want to play a video game instead, because video games tend to do that genre better, at least for me so far. But there are exceptions. And Zaya Legends of Idris system is one of the exceptions. It's a game that works well even at two-player counts. Enough things are going on in the universe around you that even at a two-player game, it's still good. A three-player game is better, in my opinion. That's where I think the game shines. Four-player starts to move more into that downtime concerns. But then also, your turns are so rewarding, and other players' turns are so cinematic that it's actually fun to be semi-fun to be involved even on other people's turns. I still like my turn the best. I'm still trying to pursue my planet, trying to gather those goods, move across the galaxy, break through that planetary shield, sell the goods, upgrade my ship, add more polyomino tiles to my ship, because your whole entire ship is like a little polyomino tile arrangement of how to fit the engines and the weapons and the shields and all those things onto your ship. There is so much going on in this game. It is so rewarding. Zaya Legend of Idris system is, it's been a classic for a very, very long time. I think it's a great experience, and I think it's a good game. It's my number 66 game of all time. My number 65 game of all time is going to be a two-player experience. That is going to be Watergate from Capstone Games. Watergate is delightful. I just played a game of this yesterday. Oh my gosh, it is. It's a game that holds up for me. The core idea of Watergate is it's a car-driven system. It's mimicking it's very loosely abstracted around the whole Watergate scandal. One player takes the side of Nixon, trying to stop the player from connecting the various witnesses to what happened, and the other side takes the side of the press, trying to connect those witnesses. Nixon's trying to gain momentum before the other player manages to connect things, and so both players have their own asymmetric goals, but ultimately it's a tug-of-war game. It's a tug-of-war game that you play out on this map over here, sliding the momentum, sliding the evidence tokens, and sliding the initiative token towards you back and forth as you play through the game, trying to decide what has the most impact and sway over your influence at any given time. What thing is the most important thing to fight over? Which battles do you think you can win? Which battles you have to leave behind? And a lot of that's going to be based on the power of the cards in your hand, the abilities of the cards in your hand, because whenever you play a card, you are playing it either for its strength or for its power, or for its ability. That also has an element of deck building in the game, or deck weeding, because some cards that you play, when you get rid of the ability, you actually make your deck a little stronger, because that card might have a lower number, so if you use it earlier on, it might be better. The tricky part is holding it for the right moment might be better too, so you have to kind of balance, when is the right moment, when do I play this card, what things do I think I can fight for and win. It is a delightfully meaty, back and forth tug of war game. There are a bunch of these tug of war type experiences that have been out in general over a long period of time. This Twilight Struggle, one of the granddaddies of the genre. There's going to be, 1965, I think it's 1965, is going to be another one in that. But Watergate gives me that in a shorter two-player experience that plays out in half an hour. It's just so, actually half an hour is probably fast. Probably something around 45 minutes. Match of the Century is another one that narrowly missed my top 100 games of all time. But Match of the Century is another game that very much has Watergate vibes and feels for me. Another game that I highly recommend you taking a look at. But that is going to be Watergate from Capstone Games and from Matthias Kramer, my number 65 game of all time. My number 64 is going to be Beast by Studio Midhall. Not the first and not the last hidden movement game we're going to have on the top 100, but Beast by Studio Midhall is a delightful game of asymmetric player powers, as you have the various hunters who are tracking the beast, all asymmetric in their own right, and then you have the beast themselves, who's going to be one of many asymmetric beasts, all with their own suite of powers. Meanwhile, you're navigating this map, which frankly, I never loved the look of the map, but functionally it does what it needs to do, as the beast takes on, as you go through a scenario, a challenge you're going through, and you're going to go ahead, contract whatever it is, you're going to be going ahead and trying to pursue your goals as the beast, while the hunters try to get in your way, each with their own scenario rules on them. The game is highly, highly variable from the scenario you're playing, from the beast you're playing against, from the hunters you're playing as. There's so much to consider as you play through Beast, but it's one of those just incredible asymmetrical hidden movement games. I think it's my second favorite hidden movement game of all time. Those of you who watch the channel know that number one is going to be something else entirely. Not number one game of all time, but my number one is higher up on this list. But either way, Beast over here is absolutely fantastic. They just had an expansion come out as well. I'm curious whether more plays of the expansion boosted up a few notches for me. But as it is, Beast is a fantastic experience. My number 64 game of all time. Which brings us to my number 63 game of all time. It's going to be another big box, which means it's going to go on top of Dominion over here. But that is going to be Marrakesh von Stefanfeld and from Queen Games. I'm realizing this box has one of the worst inserts ever, and I cannot turn this box upside down. Even as it is, I'm probably messing up the components even this way. So, you will not get to see the back of the box in this one, but Marrakesh. And the insert, by the way, the insert is trash. I have a tricky relationship with Queen Games. I think they put out some incredible stuff. I am highly complimentary of many of their games they do, and I also give them a hard time about things like inserts and crowdfunding and all those things. But, ultimately, at the end of the day, For better or for worse, Marrakesh is one of the better Euro games I have played in general this past year, whenever. And Stefanfeld is already a designer I like. This is not the first, the last, well, it is the first. It's the first Stefanfeld game I have on this particular list, but I think there's at least two more that are going to be coming up throughout my top 100. Stefanfeld is an incredible designer who does these point salad games that make you feel rewarded whatever you do, but it still gives you the challenge. So you feel rewarded no matter what you do, but you still feel incentivized to try to optimize as much as possible to get as many points as possible as you play through it. Marrakesh is a delight, an absolute delight, I say. I think it's a great game that gives you a lot of things to consider as you're trying to basically drop these keshis into a tower, have them pile out, use those to drive certain actions, because there's like 12 different actions, 11 different actions you're going to take in the game, and you're trying to drive those actions with your keshis, but trying to be mindful of what way do you think you can leverage the system to your own best interest as you try to, well, get as many points as possible. I think Marrakesh gives you a ton of things to consider, a ton of tracks to move up on, a ton of ways and reasons to want to play again. I just recently got the expansion, the Camels and Nomads, I think it is. I'm looking forward to playing that. I have not done so yet. But Marrakesh from Stefanfeld from Queen Games, part of the City Collection, delightful experience and one that I highly recommend, my number 63 game of all time. My number 62 is going to be another Euro game. In fact, my number 62 and 61 are both going to be Euros. My number 62 is Wayfarers of the South Tigris, and boy, this game surprised me. See, I've had a tricky relationship with Garfield Games and their collections of, you know, Architects of the West Kingdom, the North Sea, the South Tigris. I've had a tricky experience with them in the sense that most of their games I have enjoyed but not loved, even while the rest of the world loves them. Architects, I like. The rest of the world loves. Paladins, well, Paladins, I like. The rest of the world loves. Shipwrights, not Shipwrights. Raiders. As I like, the rest of the world loves. Then Viscounts, I really didn't like. Viscounts, I'm not even gonna say I liked. I did not like Viscounts, and the rest of the world loves. Their games in general have been incredibly popular, and the rest of the world loves. They have a lot of games in the top 100, which is kudos to them, but for whatever reason, I haven't bought into the magic quite as much. Until Wayfarers came along. Now, to be fair, I was excited for Wayfarers. When Wayfarers came out, it was dice placement. I liked dice placement as a mechanic. I was like, maybe this will be the time. But then it showed up, and I just kind of forgot and stopped caring because historically their games have not excited me as much, even when I want to like them. But then I played Wayfarers, and oh my gosh, I love this game. Wayfarers is so good. The dice placement, the card management. One of the things I've learned this past year about my taste in games and things that I like is I've noticed that whenever a game gives you a good, clean system of how it operates, and then they give you a ton of cards that you will never be able to see all the cards in every single game, and those cards mix up how you have minor adjustments or differences to that system, I found that I like that as a game concept. I like that little aspect where here's a system, and now here's why you'll never play it the same way twice. I love that. Games like Vindications, Expeditions, Wayfarers of the South Tigris, even Fall. There are so many games that hit that, and they keep doing well for me. And so Wayfarers, I love Wayfarers. It's going to be a dice placement over here. You're going to be managing the center board, moving up along the center board over here, while gathering cards that are going to go to your sideboard. There's different types of cards and different ways they're going to slot in, but you have a ton of ways you're trying to score as you manage just dice placement and the occasional worker placement too, all while dealing with all the cards around you here. This gives you a lot of things to consider. It does give a nice insert that I actually think is very nice, but not as functional as I would have liked it to be, but either way, that is going to be Wayfarers of the South Tigris, my number 62 game of all time. My number 61 is a game that's specifically this high only because of the expansions. In fact, when I first played it, I was like, it's good, and the more I added expansions, the more I found it took it from a good game that I just didn't need to keep playing to a good game that I always want to play, a great game that I always want to play. And that is going to be Istanbul from AEG. I love this game. I have all the expansions in this game. This game is such a good Euro experience. It is a tight little game of the entire movement puzzles that pulls me in. You're going to set up the board with, let's go ahead and show you again in the back over here. The board doesn't show you a great job. We'll show you a little bit. You set up the board over here with a bunch of tiles on the board. And then you're moving your merchant and their assistants around the board. Basically, you're going to have, let's say, a 4x5 grid, or it's a 5x5 grid. Depends on the expansion you incorporate. Let's say you have a 5x5 grid of different action locations. But then you have a merchant and a bunch of assistants underneath them, and you can move as far as the assistants can take you. But then the problem is you can only ever take an action if you are dropping off or picking up an assistant, which means you start with, hey, I can do whatever I want. But then as you start moving, you have to start planning around being able to pick up your assistants as you go back and forth. So you're like, hey, I drop one off, I pick one up, I take the actions. You have to kind kind of plot out what sequence of repeated back and forth actions you're going to take as you snake outwards and inwards using the various abilities of the various locations. Meanwhile, the locations give you different ways to earn gems, which is ultimately how you win the game. And so you're challenged to try to figure out what do you think is the optimum way to gather the gems you need based on what other players are doing, based on the board setup, which is different every single game. There's a ton of things to consider. It is lightweight in terms of the actual rule set, but the complexity, the nuance, of the depth of what you're doing. This is a game I can teach you and have you up and running in 10 minutes or less. Whereas like games like Marrakesh or Wayfarers, those are slightly longer teaches. Istanbul, I can get you up and running fairly quickly, but the amount of actual thinkiness going on to the experience, especially as you add expansions and more locations, to me, the Mocha and Bakshis expansion elevated the game to the next level for me. It took it from a very, very good game that I appreciated to a great game that I don't anticipate leaving my collection for a very long time. That is going to be Istanbul, my number 61 game of all time. And that ends the fourth video in our top 100 games. We'll be back next Wednesday. We'll be back Wednesday with our next video, where we go over numbers 50, number 60 through 51, where we will officially be halfway through the top 100. Until next time, I'm Alex Radcliffe from Board Game Co. I appreciate you being here, and as always, I hope you have a good one.